I'm Will Wilkinson. I'm the General Manager of WSJ Pro, and it's an absolute pleasure to be here, even at short notice this morning. That snow, turns out, there's nothing in cyber you can do to melt the snow. That's a real problem. This is a 40-minute session, so I'm going to get straight into business. We're going to cover a lot of ground here on what it is to get in front of the busy CISO, and we're absolutely delighted to have two such busy, talented CISOs with us this morning. So first, let me introduce Dan Glass. Dan has been the Chief Information Security Officer at American Airlines, a position he held for the last 6 years. He spent that previous 11 years at that company. He's also been at PepsiCo on the IT service desk, where he cut his teeth, and then roles at University of North Texas and Tetra Pak. Just as some context, so American Airlines has over 10,000 servers, 100,000 end user devices, 3,500 flights a day to 260 locations. That is quite the landscape to defend. Next is Geoff Belknap. Welcome, Geoff. Geoff is CISO at Slack. And during his 20 years in security and network architecture, he's held lots of roles, including 5 years as CISO at Palantir. He's also a startup advisor. He serves on the board of the Bay Area CISO Council and is a member of the CSIS Cyber Policy Task Force for US and International Cybersecurity Policy, which I think you'll admit just rolls off the tongue. We're going to have plenty of time.
I leave with that.
That's right. There's no rhyming slang for it in English either. It's terrible. We're going to have plenty of time at the end of this session for questions. So if it's okay, if you're thinking of questions you've got, note them down and we'll make sure we come to you with plenty of time at the end. But we're going to dive right into it. And Geoff, why don't you give us a sense of what it is in your top, what's your top priority on any given day in the role before you even think about a vendor? What's going on?
Geez, I think, you know, for me, the top priority of anybody in this role is probably pretty similar, is that we wake up at 3 a.m., you know, start craving like in a cold sweat. Oh, what have I forgotten? And then, you know, when we calm down and get back to sleep and go to work, we really try to focus on what are the main problems that my team has? What resources do they need? What people do they need? What air cover do they need? Are they getting it? How can I sort of move that ball forward? It really, at the end of the day, it really is an executive role like anything else, where the main thing I'm concerned about is the outcomes I've committed to deliver to my company and to my customers, and making sure that I'm making progress towards that.
And Dan, from your perspective, does that differ at all for you, or do you feel you spot a similar daily agenda?
Yeah, it's putting out fires, unsticking things that got stuck potentially in projects, delivery, and even sometimes the security team getting in front of other teams and having to come in and weigh my opinion in. And then obviously, checking in with the SOC and making sure the board's always green, right? That was my first call in the morning, was to our 24/7 saying, we good? Good.
All right.
So. And at what point in any given day does the need of a vendor come across your path or get a sympathetic read from you?
So at American, because of the size and the scope and the scale of that company, we had a lot of partners, from everywhere, from managed service providers providing data center services and, managing thousands of our systems to, remote location in, Spain, where they're just servicing three desktops. But we have to deal with all of them from a security perspective as well as a vendor management and relations perspective. So I spent about 10 to 15% of my time on average dealing with partners.
Really?
Yeah, quite a bit, more than you would think.
That's getting on for a day of your time a week.
Yes, wow. Once again, that's averaged, right? So there's that includes sessions where I'm offsite with them for 2 days. And, so every day didn't have like 10% blocked off, but I would say 10 is probably the low bar.
And Geoff, is that ringing a bell with you?
Yeah, I probably can't quantify it as easily, but I do think about it like this. Slack is a relatively new organization, as a business in general, although the growth has been fantastic. Just in terms of time, we haven't been around that long, but because we haven't been around that long, we're really more of a digital native, a cloud native organization. And I think what all of you will see is the thing that I'm seeing as well, which is cloud-native organizations or organizations that are relatively new, maybe founded in the last 10 years or less, are all using a combination of different vendors, right? We all depend on our partners, whether that be, you know, maybe our email is run on G Suite or we're using AWS or Google Cloud to deliver our product. But it goes much deeper than that, right? We're all using some sort of HRMS system, an applicant tracking system. You know, we're using Salesforce or things around that. And I think in my world, what I recognize is, and we just actually made an organizational change to sort of acknowledge this, we have as much to lose or to gain by investing the right resources and making sure our the way we think about security with our partners and our vendors is as innovative as the way we think about it with our traditional infrastructure. So, I would say a significant amount of my day is spent indirectly thinking about how we're going to engage with those partners.
Yeah, and can you give us a sense of how many approaches do you get in any given week? What does your email inbox look like? Are you overflowed? Oh, are you inundated? I think anyone in this room has got the name cybersecurity in their title. Technology in their title is going to be approached.
Email right now.
Yeah, I think
it's one at the back. He's like, I'm sending it right
Dan
now.
And I have both received an email or three from everyone in this room, and everyone at RSA this week. At least that's what it feels like.
Yeah, I mean, they've got to reach out, right? They're legitimately trying to make sure that their product is well known, it's well understood by you. They know they're competing for your time. So, I mean, when someone says the classic, you know, I need 15 minutes of your time, I'm not going to bother you. Like, who gets through the door? Who do you say yes to? And if you do, why? And if you could you share one recently, an example of where one made an approach that worked? Maybe
so,
Dan, can you tell
first? So right now I don't get that many, which is fantastic because I'm between roles. But when I was at American, yes, the email was largely ignored if it didn't come from somebody internal to the company and or a vendor that I did a lot of business with. And that's unfortunate because I know you guys spend time crafting those messages and sending them out. And quite honestly, most of the time it did hit the bit bucket. But every once in a while there'd be something, some title that would catch my interest. But once again, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that because I've got a ton of stuff to do in that day. And so I'm going to forward that to people in my organization that handle that kind of thing for me, in my architecture team or this, or the individual managers over a group that say, hey, this looks interesting. Go check it out. But quite honestly, yeah, the 15-minute thing, because I also know that that's never 15 minutes. Mm. If it's either 5 minutes because you just pitched something that is completely not of interest, it doesn't fit any of the check boxes I'm looking to check, or it's really interesting and now I just blew through my next meeting because I want to have that engaging dialogue and really deep dive. And so that's in larger organizations, you got to understand the CISO's probably not making product decisions. I understand in smaller companies they're much more technical. But as you as you get into larger and larger organizations, the CISO may not be the person you want to pitch first. You may want to start at a manager level or even an IC level and get them interested in the product and have them sort of figure out a way to get their manager to approve, well, can we stick this thing in a lab and just play with it a little bit, versus starting at the CISO where he's getting, there's way more you guys than there are of us. And, I got 300 emails internally each day, so you could imagine the volume that I got that wasn't internal.
So you're almost suggesting there's an internal advocacy program that could happen. There may be a better way for a company to approach you to say, we can do X, Y, and Z for you, but it comes through a recommended or a trusted person within the organization.
Yeah, so everything would flow. So even if I had an idea that I liked, I never made that decision in a vacuum, right? Because I'm the dumb guy at the top, right? I pay people to be smart for me because I have no ability to be smart anymore. So I had a team full of very talented security architects, and they had a list of questions that they would ask, and they would, challenge the idea. They would whiteboard. They would, put the team through its paces. And then at the end, if it seemed like it was something that was warranted, then once a week the architecture team would come forward with a list of here's some vendors that could potentially replace these partners that we're currently working with. Or here's somebody doing something completely different. Is this something that Dan, do you think we should do this? Does this fit into the strategy?
Interesting. And Geoff, I see you nodding. You broadly concur with that. Does that feel the same for you and your organization?
I feel like I'm, maybe 75% as smart as Dan. And
you can't have negative IQ, bro.
we'll see. We can talk about that later. I feel like, you know, I agree. I don't think 15 minutes exists, at least not in the same sense. And I looked at my email right now and I searched for 15 minutes of time and it just scrolls. So I think maybe that sales approach has had its moment in the sun. And, you know, from my perspective, I'm the same way. There's very few things that I buy that are solving problems for me directly. Everything else that we might buy as an organization is solving a problem for one of my teams or one of my departments. And in general, I like to push those decisions as close to the edge as possible. I want those people that have to live with whatever that purchasing decision that we made is, they have to live with it, they have to have that relationship, they have to feel good about that. And to the extent that they don't, they have to hold our partner, our vendor, responsible for that and accountable to that. And that can't happen if I'm holding them at arm's length and trying to maintain that relationship ourselves. So, you know, I think that, I didn't catch the name of the woman who was up here right before, but what she said that I thought was brilliant is the kind of thing where I will invest time, even if it's not a problem that I solve directly, is if it's something that's, if it's a solution where you're trying to bring it to market and I'm interested in that problem space, and there's a couple of things I think all CISOs have sort of like, there are three or four things that are really interesting solution spaces for us, I might spend an hour with you and just, you know, talk about what you're trying to do and give you some tips about the market or tell you whether the way people think about it or the way my peers think about it. And that might be completely unrelated to a sale and I might be interested or not, but beyond that, I'm probably just not going to take the meeting because you're not solving a problem for me directly. Mm. And it's not as important for me to cram down a solution to my leadership.
Yeah. So that's interesting. Maybe we could just pivot at the moment to sort of think, moving away from thinking about your established vendors and what they do for you and more to the startups that might come. And they may approach you in a way that feels jarring as a cold call, or there's an email that comes in and you think, I haven't got the time, and if one of my guys had seen this before, that'd be mean much better. But what advice would you give to a startup trying to get their idea in front of you when maybe the only mechanism they think they've got at their disposal is a cold email or a cold call? What sort of thoughts have you got on that?
Use your network. So seldom, you know, I doubt very many of you you know, graduate, or even if you graduated from college, you know people, right? You had professors, and then you meet people along your path, on your journey, and those people know other people, and those people may have an in, and those are the ins you want to look for. Once again, not directly to me, although that is a path, right? Mm-hmm. And so if you have VC backing, your VC network is amazing, because there are certain VC groups that I know have a proven track record of spotting, you know, burgeoning security talent. And if they put something in front, you know, if they just, I have one person, I'm not going to name names, but if he just sends me, he didn't even say, hi, Dan, he would just send me the name of a company. And that was it. Like, that was the email, because he was a busy guy, right? He's all over the valley and all over the world. And that's all it would take. Because then I would just instantly forward that to my architecture team and say, look at this ASAP, right? Because this guy never wasted my time before. And the solutions he brought to bear were effective, mm-hmm. and they worked, you know. So that's one way, right? Trying to work your network. And then once again, don't be afraid of going, don't think the CISO is ultimately the person that signs the check, but they're rarely the person that makes the decision, especially in a large organization, right? I can't tell you how many products that we had at American. I know I had a large portfolio, but I promise you, I only made the decision on a few of them, and that was only because they were higher dollar, right? Where I had to get involved. But my managers, I had a lot of trust in my managers, and if they said, you know, product X is the way we need to go, and I go, oh, well, that's going to piss off IBM, and you know, because they don't have to deal with that, I do, right? I have to take the meeting now with the IBM VP. You know, it's like, why are you leaving our platform for this? You know, and then lo and behold, like 6 weeks later, they get acquired or something, right, by IBM. But so I know that's a dream for y'all, but that, you know, but most of the time a nightmare for me, yeah. You know, because yeah. Now I have to deal with the company I was trying to get away from, so.
So I guess what I'm hearing is it's consistent with the way you think about anybody approaching you. It could be a startup, it could be an established vendor that you just haven't used yet. If it comes through a trusted source, a third party, then you're more likely to give it some airtime.
And there are opportunities for, like, this is a great place right now. Like this, you know, right here at RSA, and you just, you know, don't be annoying. You know, don't, you know, if we say no, you know, it's not because we don't like you or think your stuff isn't great. It's because we're probably busy and have other things to do or stuff's on our mind. So, you know, I know that the books will tell you, you know, try, give it 5 minutes, let us breathe, right? Because we have families, we have things that we are thinking about as well. So, but this is a great place, right? And I specifically look forward to RSA every year, not for the main conference floor, right? That's great for the toys for the kids and, you know, the t-shirts, but actually it's the edges of the main floor and then the small room that they've set up in this hotel for the burgeoning startups. Yeah, the sandbox.
That's interesting.
Right, that's where I spent more of my time in the last few years at RSA versus the big floor.
Because
I already own like 90% of the products that are on the main floor already, so I don't need to talk to those folks.
Yeah.
Right.
So Geoff, when you think about how startups would get an idea in front of you that you may not consider if it came through a cold call, have you seen any effective strategies? What works for you? What works for your organization?
The only thing that really works is coming to me through someone I already trust.
Yeah.
And that only really works and is only really effective is if you have signaled to me or I've heard from colleagues like Dan that you're actually solving a problem and that you sort of understand the problem you're trying to solve. I think the worst possible thing you can do is send me a cold email and say, I've got it, I've solved all your problems, and if you try to state to me you know what my problem space is like, I'm immediately turned off. But if I understand, if what you come at me with is something that acknowledges like there is a problem and that we can solve it and we've solved it for other people, that might be interesting. But I think, the bottom line is cold reach outs are rarely ever gonna work for some of us. The other thing to keep in mind is you just have to focus on doing a great job and delivering an outcome that you've committed to one of my peers, because we all talk and we all know each other. I think, last night at 10 o'clock, Tim wasn't gonna be here and I was like, great. I have a Slack with 95 other CISOs in it and I've met most of them in person. Dan and I met in person for the first time today, but we've talked for ages and we spent a lot of that time interacting with our peer community. I'd say maybe like half of it is discussing vendors. And some of it's vendor relationships. Some of it's like, did you get a box of beef jerky? I got a box of beef, that's weird.
Yeah.
Stop sending weird stuff. Like our teams appreciate it because we end up giving it to them, but like, you're not getting the kind of attention you think you are for whatever clever thing you sent. My kids appreciate it, I guess. but I think the bottom line is, if we can identify through people that we know, even if it's a cold reach out and we've heard your name before, if we can talk to one other person in our network that has experienced your product or your solution or even your like sales process, like that's gonna take you way further than the most clever Nerf gun assortment you sent us. because then, all I care about, I'm spending all my waking hours working on these really challenging problems are, who can help me move forward? Who can help me move forward further and faster than where I currently am? Not, what's neat or who had the coolest white paper or neat stunt hack at the RSA floor. It's just, it's just purely, who can consistently help me execute better?
Mm-hmm. So it's an interesting point, isn't it? Because there's a chicken and egg moment for a startup. Where what you're saying is it's great if one of the people in your Slack network or your peer group or a VC that you know can endorse this person, but at some point they've got to get endorsed and they've got to get one foot in the door. Have you seen any good examples of where that first foot in the door has really paid off for someone, or where in your network somebody's come to you and said, "Wow, this guy sent me a box of beef jerky. I was stupid enough to take the phone call, but it's good beef jerky," and I said yes, and then now it solved my problem for me. Does that ever happen?
It's really rare. I think what's most frequent is I spend a lot of time sort of understanding what's in the new startup space, especially for things that are interesting to me. And I'll reach out occasionally and say, hey, that's neat. I want to hear more about it. But I think what Dan said is really the number one thing. If you're a startup, especially if you're VC funded, but if you're just new, work that network, right? If you're going to take advisors on, make sure they're advisors that can connect you to other trusted people. Because like I said, I'll also take a meeting, even if it's not a problem I'm trying to solve, just frankly, because I think all CISOs have a vested interest in making sure the vendor space gets better, right? Right now, it's getting better, but it's still really tough, which is why I think we're happy to do things like this and sort of talk about what the problems are. There's a fantastic podcast that Mike Johnson and David Sparks are doing right now called the CISO Vendor Relationship Podcast. I think these kind of things are starting to edge away where there's so many new startups in this space. We have to have a dialogue about what's working and not working. Otherwise, if you never get in front of me, we're losing. it's not good.
Yeah. Dan, does that ring bells with you?
Yeah, I fully agree. I mean, you know, it, in order to make sure that we're successful, you guys need to be successful, right? Because obviously systems aren't being patched timely enough and applications aren't written securely enough by themselves. And so we need security product out there to help us deal with those threats, right? And then obviously we have all of the SOC stuff that we have to worry about and identity, stuff that a company like American, we're not in the business of writing software. We do it, but only in, you know, for specific business functionality, not for generic things that we can just get off the shelf. So,
right.
Or they can, I guess. It's hard to get away from the we thing when you're with somebody for so long. You know, that network is important. And in one, the advisory board and council is also a great idea, right? So you get a couple of people, and I could tell you personally that three or four vendors, we actually, you know, didn't get very far with some of them because they were way too early for something like American. Like they wanted to, you know, do magic in the cloud, and we were like, well, what magic? Like, it's magic. Like, but and wait, what? It's secure. Now they're actually a real company with a real product. But I got that early connection, and I gave them that feedback. Like, you're just, I don't know what you're telling me. You're saying you're going to secure me in the cloud, but you can't give me details. Are you still figuring out what that means too? Because I know I am. And you know, but those conversations that I had early on with those startups, which I wouldn't have had if it didn't come through, you know, my chief legal counsel, or if it didn't come through, you know, another executive at American, or like I said, through, you know, somebody, a partner that I already have external, a channel partner or something, you know, those conversations would never happen. They wouldn't get that feedback, and they wouldn't have been able to iterate and start targeting those larger companies, right? Because, you know, you guys have great ideas, but more likely than not, most of the ideas out there are not ready for a company like American, right? And, you know, the vendor management cycle that we're going to put you through is going to, you know, wear you guys down to a nub, and then the testing that we put you through, and then you have to, you know, and then we can't break stuff, right? I mean, stuff can't fail. So if you have an agent that goes on a desktop or on a server, you know, expect a year, you know, of testing and retesting and then negotiation and then retesting again, right? Because the stakes get really high when you're talking about a global airline where, you know, DFW goes down for 30 minutes and you're talking probably about a, you know, at least a 10 to 12 hour impact for flights being delayed around the world.
Yeah. So I guess it's probably fair to say that CISOs have got a list of things they need to fix at any one time. Mm-hmm. And ideally, you know, the perfect pitch would be coming through the door for the, I needed to fix that. So glad you turned up. Does that ever happen? Do you ever arrange for the fixes you need to be known by the marketplace, so entrepreneurs or startups or established vendors can respond to that for you?
I don't. You know, I.
Is it that
don't.
Ideal?
I mean, it's tough, right? You have hard problems, and you also have to be careful about what signals you send to the marketplace, right? So, I don't think I could sort of list out here's a laundry list of problems I'm working on without people misinterpreting, you know, the degree to which we're working on them. That being said, I think, you know, I think everyone has a common set of problems, and you know, to different degrees or another. Certainly, those change by the vertical. And I think there have definitely been startups that have been successful, sort of saying like, we solve this one problem. We find a lot of people have this one problem. We also do other things, but you know, if you have this problem to solve, give us a call. Like, great. I don't delete any of these messages you all send me. And if I run into a thing, and I know someone sent me an email about it before, I'll go back and look for that. I think it's really tough. I don't know about you, but it's really tough for me to sort of be clear about these are the things I'm looking for to solve.
So I actually went back to my architecture and education roots, and developed a route. We had a strategy in American. I mean, you would hope that a company like American has a strategy. So I hope I'm not telling you something that's a surprise. But we actually created a rubric that we would use to score, and I would use inside my head to score potential partners, future, you know, good ideas. So we had a strategy, and it was, you know, an acronym, and each of the letters of the acronym obviously meant something. And where did you fit? Because that was my strategy. So if you didn't fit into one of those four categories, then you probably weren't going to be, you were going to be an outlier. And I didn't like outliers, because that means that that's a more administrative overhead. That's a team that is now doing things that are not core to the mission that they were, meant to do, because we had our organization organized that way, right, by the strategy. So And so what I would do is I would score them. As we were talking, I would ask leading questions to get the answers, and I would put them in the categories, and some, you know, bonus points if you landed in more than one. But then I would, I wouldn't tell them what I thought, but then I would explain our strategy. It's pretty simple. I get through it in about 2-3 minutes. And then I would ask them where they place themselves. What categories do you see yourselves solving? You know, where do you fit into American Airlines ecosystem? And sometimes they nailed it. And, you know, most of the time they said, oh, well, we fit them all. Okay. Explain, right? Tell me why you think you fit, you know, why you make systems rugged, or, you know, blah, blah, blah. And we would have that dialogue. And sometimes they would nail, you know, great answers, and I didn't think about their product that way, or we didn't get to that point. And sometimes they didn't have good answers, and, you know, and that's okay, like, you know, because they weren't trying to sell, and I understand. But understanding that when you're dealing with, like, a CISO or even just a large security team, you know, you come prepared like that, like thinking, how am I going to solve their problem? Not the CISO's problem, as Geoff, like, that was brilliant, right? But how am I going to solve the company's problem? It may be a problem they don't even know they have yet. I can't, you know, there's been a number of vendors that came to me and said, like, we're pitching this idea. It's like, oh, crap. Like, that's a good idea. Like, what are we doing for that? Right? Well, do something about that. So.
Yeah. Yeah. And Geoff, do you feel someone approaches you with a you know, we can fit all these categories of a problem you have? Are you skeptical about that, or do you help them, you know, figure out their answer?
Yeah, I'm super skeptical. I think I have the benefit of having been involved in early stages in other startups and being on the go-to-market side. And I had I can't remember his name now, but I had an interaction with a really well-experienced account rep, and I was sort of playing the role of a sales engineer for whatever it was at the time. And I felt I had taken the mantra of the company I worked for so to heart, and I was like, no, we're good at everything. All these things we deliver are great. And I'm sitting across from the CIO, and he's like, you can't be good at everything. Like, you know, it worries me that you honestly believe you're good at everything, because that's not how life works. And sales rep pulled me aside afterward. He's like, that meeting was great, except for the part where you blew it. And had a conversation about that. And I thought it was a great reminder that, like, look, you might have a broad product offering, especially as you're starting out early. There might be a bunch of different verticals or categories you feel like your solution fits into. But the reality is, like, it probably addresses one or two of those things really, really well. The rest are about sort of getting visibility. I think, to the extent that your sales team and the people that are crafting the narrative about your product really understand the things that you are best at and carry those forward, that honesty really translates to me. Because I know if you're going to be direct with me, even though your marketing slick or your battle card or whatever it might say, there's 1,000 categories and Gartner or whoever has put it, IDC has put us in the top left or top right corner, those things don't impress me. But what do impress me, and that what immediately I recognize, is like, there's a partner. I'm sitting across the table from somebody that will partner with me and then work with me, is somebody that's honest and somebody that's direct and straightforward and will not just regurgitate what's on the marketing slick. Like, that's not useful. What is useful is having, if I have taken the time, if Dan's taken the time, if any CISO or any purchasing person has taken the time to meet with you, it is only to distill the bullshit that we have read. I promised I wasn't going to say that. Sorry, Kate. It is only the stuff that we have read in your marketing material that we want to distill down to, like, the actual facts, and then sort of decide how that meets our problem space. Like, if you can do that, if you can invest in the salespeople and the technical staff that will do that with me, like, that's going to take you way further than like SEO or, you know, trying to buy ads.
So in that scenario, is it possible for there to be, you know, an established vendor who can solve the problem you have, but you still would consider somebody who is not necessarily known to your startup, who may be able to do it? And you might take that, I'm not sure it's fair to call it a risk, but you might take that considered step forward to evaluate them.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah, I think, you know, I guess it depends on the company you're talking to, right? Do they have a large security team with a big budget or not, right? There were lots of times where the question was the answer was and not or, and that's important. And there were lots of times where I would buy a product that do 5 things, but I only needed one of them. And I was only going to use one of them because the other 4 were interesting and good, and maybe someday I could replace it, but Moya, I got to retool my team. I gotta talk to that, you know, I already have an agreement with that vendor. I can't just walk them out the door. I already paid for it for a year, right? And or I, you know, God forbid, I negotiated the deal like 5 years ago, and you know, and it's super cheap, and you want to replace it for like 10x the cost. Yeah, I mean, that's gonna be tough for you when I only want the one thing.
Yeah.
So, you know, understanding that and then being flexible with your own solutions to say, oh, well, yeah, we can sell you just that one feature. Like, we hadn't thought of it that way, but we can license it to, you know, you promise you're not gonna do it? It's like, yeah, no, my team wouldn't even know to turn it on.
Yeah.
So,
I think it's also easy for larger established vendors to get complacent with the relationship. And our world changes day to day. So if you've gotten complacent with a relationship, you think that just because, to Dan's point, I've written that check 5 years in a row, five renewals in a row, that I'm going to keep writing that check. Absolutely, there's a perfect opportunity almost every case where there's an established vendor for someone new that just solves one problem, that one part of that solution, 10% better. I'm still interested in having that conversation.
So is there? That's really interesting, because you're actually looking for a sort of revolving selection of vendors in that scenario. Is there a scenario where inside a large organization like an American Airlines, or say take a Boeing or a Walmart or one of those real behemoths, where it actually, taking a proof of concept to them, taking a beta product to them, could actually, you know, benefit them? Or do you think they'll just get lost in the sort of enormity of an organization, get squashed before they even get out of proof of concept?
I think that's a double-edged sword, because you're going to learn a lot from a company like Walmart or Boeing, or any of the Fortune, you know, 150, 250 companies. However, you know, and I'm going to use one of your terms, you're burning a runway, right? And you're using up valuable time and resources to make things happen at a company that may never actually buy your product, and you may be, you know, and you may never fit that market segment or that size and scope of a company.
So we're going to open up to the floor in just a second, but I've got one last question for you, which is, what if there was a Tinder for startups?
Oh.
Is there a Tinder
there
for startups?
There is a Tinder.
Yeah.
Is it here?
Swipe left, swipe right.
Is it here?
Yes.
I don't know. I mean, maybe.
Yeah.
I think there are a lot of people that try to do that, but it's tough.
Yeah.
I think it's tough at the end of the day, because you know, I think one of the things Dan's getting towards when he's talking about using up runway is, if you're really early, it's easy to have the conversation, it's tough to execute. At the end of the day, even though I'm not the size of American Airlines, although maybe in compute power, I still have high-end regulatory and compliance requirements and legal obligations I've made with my customers. You have to be there and have to execute.
I remember those negotiations.
Yeah. You have to execute. I'm not, just because I'm new to the block in terms of time doesn't mean I'm not going to ask you all the same hard questions that Boeing or Walmart or American is going to ask, because they're my customers and they flowed through a lot of those asks to me.
Yeah.
You have to be ready to address that in some way, or talk about how you're going to address it quickly. So if you've gotten in front of me and you've made an impression, be ready to then execute.
Yeah, fascinating. Let's see what the audience has got to ask us. Any questions from the floor? There's a gentleman over on the left here.
First of all, thank you. Can you, I'd love to hear your perspective on how the CISO role has evolved within the last 5 years, and can you give it within the context of how the board views the role, how the leader team views the role, and what you've learned within the last 5 years?
That's a talk unto itself, yeah. Man. I mean, wow, that's a big, the CISO role has definitely changed. And I think we're still figuring it out. And I'm being very transparent. There's a few CISOs out there that have figured it out, I think, maybe. But even they probably would say, no, I haven't figured it out yet. Every day is different. You know, we're technical people by nature, most of us, and learning the business side. And not just learning like the X's and O's of how to do a budget, but actually learning the business and how does a company make money and what are the company's risks. And then yes, and then getting in front of the board and not overwhelming them with data as we are, you know, apt to do in our site, because we're technical and we want to share all of the great things we do. But at the end of the day, they just want to know, are we at risk and what do you need to lower that risk?
Yeah, I think, I mean, the thing I'd say is we have yet to come to a moment like chief financial officers did, or even GCs before that, where it was sort of like, I think Alex Stamos or Bob Lord kind of came up with this analogy first, where you know, pre-Enron, people were sort of understood what the CFO did, and we agreed on what the responsibilities were, but skin in the game was a tough thing to find, and it was tough to put your finger on as a public investor exactly what a CFO was accountable for. We don't have that yet with CISOs, and I think New York State is sort of starting to lay the groundwork for that, but broadly, there's no exact, you know, exact overlapping set of responsibilities. There's nothing, you know, there's no requirement in most cases for a CISO to make a regular report to the board or ever be in front of the board. And I think that I'm definitely seeing that shift, and I think that's changing, but I think we have still yet to land on exactly what a CISO is. And I think, you know, what's a CSO versus a CISO? That's a philosophical debate. So we still have time to mature there.
And plenty of time to talk it over after the session as well. There's a question over here.
Thank you guys, obviously, for talking. So my name is John Entwistle. I'm the co-founder of coder.com. We actually have a few people at Slack who use us.
Great, thanks.
And so we're launching our enterprise platform. We just closed our seed round, and we've been contacted by Gartner and a bunch of the consulting agencies to sort of help us craft it since it's so early. So I wanted to get your guys' opinion on working with those consultants as an early stage startup on creating an enterprise platform.
I mean, the main thing I would tell you, if you're an enterprise startup, is focus on the things that are gonna be useful to you in the near term, and then, you know, be measured about how you're focusing on the long-term things, right? If you're early stage, you don't necessarily need to have that conversation with Gartner quite yet. I think the first thing you need to focus on is making relationship with the customers and delivering on what you set out to deliver.
Great, I think we'll take another question from this side.
Hey, thanks for coming out.
We can hear you.
We can hear you.
So, thanks for coming out. So I just got a quick question. So as far as looking at when someone does like a sales pitch to you guys, what's most important to you guys as far as metric goes? Do you guys still look at ROI, or is it like something like functionally so, I guess, problem solving that you guys would be thrilled to go for?
There is no security ROI.
I mean, if you're pitching that, I'd take that.
Don't pitch it.
The easiest answer is to say, you know, pitch me on what you're solving. What are you actually making and doing? And the rest, all those questions will come later when I'm excited by the problem you solve.
Yeah, you mentioned some comments about helping your vendors get better. And I'm just curious, are there particular areas for improvement or typical like trends that you're seeing where vendors are not improving enough or not aligning enough to your objectives?
So I think you have a couple of use cases there. So you have the niche company that does one thing and they do it well, but then they don't focus on the X's and O's of execution. As Geoff mentioned before, you have to be able to execute, you have to be able to scale. You know, we're not interested in buzzwords. So, you know, and dashboards, those, you know, I'm not worried about that, but I am worried that you're not gonna crash our systems and or that your stuff's effective, right? So if you're scanning our systems and the reports are all coming back green, and then all of a sudden, you know, another company comes in and does another type of scan that is similar, and boom, you know, all of a sudden everything's red. Well, now we got a problem, right? Because there's a trust issue there. So I think do your thing and do it well. Don't try to go wide, right? Don't try to be an Oracle or a Cisco right off the bat. You can't, right? And you shouldn't, because I won't be that mean. They get complacent there. And so you really want to focus on doing the thing, doing it well, and being able to execute quickly and at scale.
Cool. Also, just one more thing. Be ready for the things we weren't expecting to deal with you as a startup. I have no idea what startup you're with, so you probably do this great. But one of the things I find is really deflating for me is if I'm taking a risk and I, you know, want to help my team move something forward, and you don't have the ability to integrate with my single sign-on, or like you don't do SAML or role-based access control. Like everybody in this room, if you've got an early startup, go to I think it's enterpriseready.io. And I think they're a startup as well, but they've put out something that's really great that explains these are like the fundamental features that an enterprise organization needs in terms of logging and audit and sign-on, things like that. Because if you've expended all this effort to impress a CISO that you solved this problem, and then you come in and I can't implement it because you don't have the basic controls I need, like you've burnt all that runway for nothing.
Yeah, I think a good way to look at it from a developer, you know, you have functional requirements and non-functional from, you know, from a product perspective, but you also have that on a delivery perspective, right? So all the things that Geoff's talking about, security, you know, your ability to sign a contract with a company like American, who has, you know, a team of lawyers and vendor management specialists that will, you know, beat you to a bloody pulp if you're not prepared for that. Or you'll just sign some agreement that, you know, if something goes wrong, we own your company. I mean, we didn't do that, but I'm sure.
You might try.
Yeah, well, we would, no, we wouldn't, because that's not our game, but I'm sure that that sort of thing has happened before, right? Where you're just not, you know, you're so eager to make the deal, you're signing away the farm, right? And so be ready for those type of things too. Be ready for us as much as we need to be ready for you.
Cool, thank you.
So I hope we've got 30 seconds left for one last question.
It'll definitely be the last question.
Yep.
And we can go over just a little bit, no problem.
Okay, great. Please.
No pressure, but this is going to be a great question.
Awesome. So my name is Carlo, and I was curious because you had mentioned that in order to reach you, you prefer to have somebody you trust refer you, right? So I'm curious, what do you look for? What stands out to you, right? And what problems are you looking to solve when it comes to, okay, somebody's sending me an email like, not this one. That's the, what do you look for?
I mean, for me, I won't delete. I'll hit archive super fast if in the subject line or the first line of the message, you just piss me off. And here are the kind of things that can piss me off. If you say, you're already hacked and you just don't know it yet, and you think that's a really cute intro to like whatever you do, I'm like, archive, no thanks. Just the quicker you can get to, hey, you don't even have to acknowledge I'm busy. I get it, everyone's busy. It's not just that I'm busy, you're busy too. Just get to like, what do you solve, and like, what are you addressing? Even if your message is like three lines long, but it explains crisply the problem that you solve and the solution that you offer for that, like, great. If like that's probably enough, I'll reach back out. But everything else that's like, oh, a Gartner study said this, or like, and God, I will find you if you send me some FUD in the email that like loosely aligns to like, oh, you're hacked, or you're gonna be hacked, or you're irresponsible for not solving this problem. Like, don't, just tell me what problem you solve. And if I don't have that problem right now, I'm gonna at some point, or I'm gonna know somebody, Dan's gonna be like, hey, have you heard of any companies that do X? Like, I'm gonna tell, like, oh yeah, I've got these.
Yeah, and he'll forward all those emails to me.
Okay. I just forward all my emails to Dan. Yeah.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I think that was a fascinating conversation. Geoff, Dan, we've heard practical things, philosophical things. We're able to do beef jerky. And if you get it wrong, Geoff's going to find you. Well done. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you.